Hey guys, today I'd like to do something a bit different. I want to answer a question that I saw recently on the OpenGL forum on Reddit. And the question was, does GLM rotate model matrices around the center of the screen? Now, this question was answered by several people here on the forum, but I thought it would be a good opportunity to create a demo to demonstrate the importance of order of the transformations. And basically, the person is asking, how do I let images with different positions have a rotation along its own axis? Let's see a demo. Okay, so we have a box which is rotating around the origin. Now let's take a look at the code. Okay, so we have a matrix here called rotation matrix, and I'm initializing it to rotate around the Y axis. Okay, now I'm not using GLM here because I always want to be in full control of all the math stuff, but basically GLM should work in exactly the same way. So if you want to understand how rotation matrices are being created, you can go to this webpage on my website. And in general, we use a combination of the cosine and the sine function in order to create the rotation. As you can see, in this case, the coordinates are specified as X and Y. So this means that we are rotating around the Z axis. Okay, so this creates the matrix around the Z axis right here. And by organizing the same equations a bit differently, you get a rotation matrix for the Y axis and for the X axis. Okay, so GLM works basically the same way. This is called the Euler angle rotation. And you also have the possibility to use quaternions if you want to rotate around an arbitrary vector, but let's keep it simple for now and just use these matrices, okay? So we initialize the rotation matrix and we copy it into the world matrix, and we take the view matrix from the camera as usual, and we multiply the world by the view and the projection to get the WVP matrix, which is plugged into the shader right here, okay? So let's take a look at the vertex shader. And we can see that we're multiplying the WVP matrix by the position. And the position vector is on the right-hand side of the multiplication. Okay, so this is very important. This is basically us doing something like that. Okay, so we take the projection matrix and we multiply it by the view, which is multiplied by the world, which is multiplied by the position. Okay. Let's add a multiplication here and here just to make it a bit clearer. Okay, so if we were to send all these three matrices separately to the shader, this is what we had to do, okay, to multiply the world by the position, and the result will be multiplied by the view, and then the result of that will be multiplied by the projection, okay? So instead of doing these three separate transformations, we just combine it in the application code to get the WVP matrix, and then we multiply it by the position. Okay, so it's the same thing. So this is just a background material, and after we set the WVP matrix into the shader, we render the box. Now I'm using a box model which is loaded from an OBJ file using SMP. I have a tutorial about it. I'll put the link down below if you're interested. But in general, we can take a look at the box. And we can see that all the vertices are either 1 or minus 1 on their coordinates. Okay, so the box goes from minus 1 by minus 1 by minus 1 up to 1 by 1 by 1. So the origin is located at the center of the box. Now, you can create the same box by manually populating the vertex buffer and the index buffer, and the end result will be the same. I'm using this method because it is simpler, okay? Okay, so let's recap. We have a rotation matrix, which rotates each vertex around the y-axis, which is why the entire box rotates around the y-axis. So the way that the rotation matrix is being constructed is that we use the cosine and sine functions to basically rotate a point around the center of the coordinate system, okay, around the origin. This is why these kinds of rotations always work around the origin. So the distance between the point and the origin doesn't really matter because the rotation matrix is built around the cosine and sine of angles, okay? So if the point is further away from the origin, we'll be getting a larger circle. And if it is closer to the origin, we'll get a smaller circle. And the rotation matrix only depends on the angle which is created right here between the point, the origin, and whatever axis which is used as the baseline, okay? So what happens when we throw in a translation and we want to do both a rotation and a translation? And here, the order of transformations comes into play. Okay, so let's see it through an example. Okay, I have a matrix right here called translation matrix, and I initialize it to do translation, 2 units along the x-axis. And now we need to combine this with the rotation. So basically, we have 2 options here. We can apply the translation first, followed by the rotation, or we can apply the rotation first and then the translation. Okay, so before we think about it further, let's see the difference between these 2 options. Okay, translation matrix first, then rotation. Now remember that the position is always multiplied on the right-hand side, and the order of evaluation is from the right to the left. Okay, so first the translation multiplied by the position, and then the rotation. Okay, and we can see the effect. Okay, the box is rotating around the origin at some distance from it, which is basically our translation. Let's think what happened here. Okay, so this is basically our y-axis, and previously we had a point right here, and we applied the rotation that made it go around the y-axis. Now we're translating the point, and then we're applying the same rotation. So now the point is further away from the y-axis, so it goes along a larger circle, right? So if you're doing that to all the vertices in the box, we're basically getting the effect that we're seeing. Now let's see the other option. First the rotation, followed by the translation. And now the box is 2 units from the origin along the positive y-axis, and it is rotating about its center. So now what happened is that the box was rotated around the origin, and then a translation was applied to all the vertices, so they move together along with the center of the box. So the key point that you need to remember is that when you apply a rotation on an object which has the origin of the coordinate system in its center, so all the vertices go along a small circle around the origin. And then when you translate them, you're basically moving them all together along one vector. Whereas if you apply the translation first and then the rotation, they still need to go along the same circle around the same origin, okay? Because it's the same transformation, only the circle is now larger. Let's do another example. Let's rotate around the x-axis, same rotation angle. And let's start with just the rotation and see the effect. Okay, so the box is rotating around the x-axis, and everything makes sense. Let's try the 2 combinations with the translation. Okay, let's begin with the translation first, followed by the rotation. Okay, so the box is rotating around its center, but it is 2 units on the positive x-axis. Okay. Let's reverse it, rotation first, followed by translation, and we're getting the same thing. Because it doesn't matter whether you do the translation first and then the rotation, or the rotation and then the translation, because the distance from each vertex to that axis that goes through the object remains the same. This means that in order for the order of transformations to have an effect, you need to have a translation along one axis and a rotation around another axis. So let's go back to the question, and we can see that basically the request is to have images or models with different positions and have a rotation along their own axis. Okay, so let's add another object. So if we just render the same mesh twice, obviously we won't see an effect, right? The 2 meshes will override each other. So what we need to do is to have different world transformation matrices for each object. So let's take the same translation matrix. And this time we'll translate along the negative x-axis. We need to recalculate the world transformation matrix. Okay, and then also the WVP matrix, which is affected by all these transformations. And we need to tell the shader that we're using a different WVP matrix this time. And let's see what happens. Okay, so in this case, the order of transformations doesn't have an effect. So each box is rotating based on its position along the x-axis. Now let's rotate the second box around the y-axis as we did initially. So we have a rotation around the y-axis and then a translation. So the second box is in the same location on the negative x-axis, but this time it is rotating around the y-axis as expected. And if we change the order to do the translation first, and then the rotation around the Y, now it is going around the center. And this shows that you only need a single instance of the vertices in some vertex buffer. And then by applying different transformations on it, you can render it multiple times in different positions along the screen, different rotation and different scaling. All you need to do is to calculate the specific world transformation for that object in the new position, rotation, scaling, whatever. Don't forget to combine it with the view and projection matrices to get the WVP matrix, update the shader, and then render the same vertices again. So what happens if you get a model that for some reason was not created around the origin and you want to rotate it around its center? So in this case, you will need to find its center by using some technique such as a bounding box. So you would need to create a translation matrix based on that center that you found, but only in the negative, okay? Because you're trying to move that center back to the origin with the entire object around it, okay? So if the center happens to be on like 10, 0, 0, you would need to translate it by minus 10, 0, 0 to bring it back to the origin, and then you can apply the rotation. So I don't have a demo for this case, but this is something to just keep in mind. Okay, so that's it for today. You can find the link to the question and the source of the demo in the video description below. If you enjoyed this video and you found it helpful, please hit the like button and subscribe if you haven't already. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next tutorial.